Hey, Sashan, what's going on? Tim Kaine, a couple weeks ago, talked about things that, how was it? Reference, not references, but where he got his ideas for the Fallout 1 setting. That was interesting. Stuff he. Real life stuff that he envisioned for his Fallout 1 setting. This video is different though. This video apparently is about the origin of the Fallout setting for Fallout 1. So we'll see. We will see what's going on here. Aziz Light.
Hi everyone, it's me, Tim. Today I want to talk about the beginning, the creation of the origin of the Fallout setting. If you remember what I said in my video about design documents, it all starts with setting. And I want to talk about that. What prompted me to think about this was somebody I know who's in the industry, I've never worked with him, said I'd be interested to know more about how Fallout setting got created. And I thought I had mentioned it, but looking back, I've dropped little bits and pieces here and there in other videos. So I'm going to try to make you a timeline of what happened. To create this timeline, I had to do a lot of research. I had both digital and actual packed away notes. And while going through those boxes, that's when I found this shirt, which I don't think I've worn in 5 years. So minimum, maybe longer. That's why it's all wrinkly. Sorry. But it also made me realize that I don't always remember things, and neither do other people I talk to, because I found dated written notes that mention some things I'm like, I don't remember that. So it's sort of.
Yeah, I do that too. I'll find a box. Stuff that's been in a box, since before I was married. And I open it up and I'm like, who wrote this? This looks like my handwriting. Like, I don't remember writing this. Different settings for RPGs and stuff back in the 80s. And it's like, what is this? Is it usable? Is it something that current day role players could use? That kind of thing. And then I'm like, oh yeah, in college I took a class, a creative writing class, and this was in a notebook for that journal I was writing every day. You had to write every day, just something, just to stay practicing. And yeah, it was pages from that journal. It's like, wow. And one day I used to have a blog, a fiction blog, and I would post every week I would post a little short story on my blog. They were all Twilight Zone type episodes with twist endings. And I'm gonna see if I can find those. I know they're not on this computer, and that blog is long gone. GeoCities, is GeoCities still around? Maybe on the archive.org, maybe I could find something.
Sort of like the naming of Fallout, where when I actually went back and looked at the names we came up on the brainstorm meeting, where Brian Fargo was not there, and then I went to talk to Brian about naming days later, or maybe even a week later, and he thought of Fallout. I think he really did come up with that name independently. I don't think he had heard our list. But if somebody asked me who came up with the name, if you had asked me until a few months ago, I would have said Brian Fargo. But whoever was in that meeting would probably go, no, that name was mine. That's why it's so hard to pinpoint who was the original source of an idea. Because there's no doubt in my mind that Brian thought of that name independently. And he was the one who explained why it was such.
Like, who knows, this RPG crusade thing that's starting up. Maybe, in a few years someone's going to say, who started the RPG crusade? Who was it? Who came up with that name? And I'm just going to say it was Tyler. It was Flame Zombie who did it. Oh, I like his shirt. Gosh, I've seen other people wearing these shirts. They must have been like at the Fallout booths or something back in the 90s. There's like remakes of this shirt on, I almost said Craigslist, but eBay. I think on eBay you can find these shirts.
Such a good name. And so he's the one he's the one responsible for the name Fallout. Even if, yes, somebody, and I don't remember who, thought of the name first. There's a lot of things like that. So let me get into the creation of the Fallout setting. And along the way, we can talk about, you know, who had the ideas and when they actually took hold. So according to my notes, Fallout kicked off, what would become Fallout, in early 94 when Interplay announced, hey, we're looking for an RPG license. And that's when I was like, I want GURPS. But GURPS is just a set of mechanics. It's not a set of rules. Steve Jackson came out in early 94 to see the company, see the people. We spent the whole day. It was super.
What he means by mechanics and rules in a game, the rules, there's rules for a game. But the mechanics aren't the rules of the game. The rules would be to talk to an NPC. You walk up to them. You click on them, and a dialogue menu pops up. And then these are the things you can say, and using your stats and your charisma and all that kind of stuff, these are the things you can convince the mechanic of letting you do. And then here's the rules for entering a room. Here's the rules for placing objects in rooms. Here's the rules for NPCs, the rules for what NPCs can do in the game, the rules for what kind of landscape there is, the size of the map, the size of the hexagons in the game. You know, should there be hexagons inside the vault or just squares inside the vault? You know, what kind of monsters are there? How fast does each monster move? What weapons does everybody have? How do the weapons work? The mechanic is just the die roll when these things collide into each other. You know, when you have to determine a random thing. Something random involving the player. Usually it's going to be combat. Or it's going to be influencing or persuasion, sneaking. You know, something your attribute is trying to accomplish, or something your skill is trying to accomplish, that would be a skill. That would be a die roll. That would be a mechanic. But everything else going on in the game, not related to the mechanics, is rules. Like, which NPC, you know, what are the NPCs' names? Those are rules. What are the relationships between the NPCs? Those are rules. What's the reputation of everybody with each other in the game? Those are rules. And all these rules have to be designed on a board or on a project management thing or Zoom meetings. I don't know. You have to document. You already have the game mechanic, but now you have to do the rules, which is the setting. The rules become the setting at some point.
For fun, we went to Club 33 up in Disneyland. It was a great day. We played Illuminati. Someone corrected him on the rules. Anyway, in late that month, so this is still March of 94, I sent Steve Jackson Games a whole box of Interplay titles. So I said, okay, you've met us, you've seen the company, here's a lot of games we've made. All I remember, because I don't actually have, you know, I don't have signed contracts, somewhere between then and June is when we got signed on. The only people assigned to the project at the beginning, it was me. I had a producer, Tom. All I know is by September, Tom was no longer assigned. He had 22 different projects, or project SKUs is what they're called.
That means you do it all by yourself.
He was swamped. So at some point, Alan Pavlos, the executive producer, just told me, just handle it. Just take care of it. So with Tom off, just me. But I did find in June, I had forgotten about this. John M. Ford, ooh, the science fiction fantasy author who also loved role-playing games and was involved with SJ Games on some of their written materials.
Didn't he write a book called X Marks the Ped Walk? He was a Car Wars guy. He wrote stuff. He wrote little shorts. I want to say he contributed to Champion's second edition, maybe? Or he wrote an adventure for it or something? He would do little short little novels. I wonder if he's still around. But that was that was 40 years ago. He was probably old 40 years ago.
Had sent us a proposal for a setting. Because remember, with GURPS, we just got mechanics. I don't remember much about the setting. I do not have a copy of it. But I found a single line note I wrote in June of 94 that said, Chris Taylor, along with Tom Decker and myself, had a phone call. We had a conference call with John M. Ford about his design for a non-linear time travel GURPS CRPG. This is not the dinosaur time traveling game we came up with later. It was I remember it was time travel, and it was quite non-linear, not just because of it being a game, but because
I always find it interesting how a setting gets made, because it's like usually, like, I'll talk to a friend, I'll bounce an idea off of him, he'll have an idea of what he's working on, and I'm like, hey, that's kind of cool. And then you spend 3 days kind of thinking about it over the weekend, and then in about an hour you just crank it out and copy paste it out there in the world, and it becomes the Siren Geist Worm from Mongoose Traveler Second Edition. This traveler doesn't have scary creatures. It doesn't have overpowered, not so much overpowered creatures, but just things that can get into your head, which then, you know, gets into the player character's head, which gets into your head when you're playing. And in one paragraph, in like two or three sentences, I have to describe some sort of creature. I don't think anyone used it, because, you know, traveler players don't roleplay. They just breathe over the most of the pages in the book. And they skip over the animal section every time. But I thought, you know what? I don't care. It's going in the book. It'll be there. Someone might look at it and go, oh, that's weird. But they'll never use it because they don't know how to roleplay, so they don't know how to use the creature. That was the thing. So many complaints from non-role players about Traveler. It was crazy. Everyone complained. There was roleplay elements in the rules. There was roleplay elements in the mechanic. And everyone complained that there was no starship construction rules. It's like no one cares about alien race creation or anything, or not the planet creation stuff, world generator. I made sure that matched first edition Mongoose. You know, planets from first edition at least will work with second edition rules. So the rules from first edition Mongoose Traveler to second edition Mongoose Traveler, the world creation rules are basically verbatim, word for word, in each edition. That was me. That was making sure that happened. And the combat's pretty much the same. They may have changed something about the dexterity, You know, for grappling or for opposed rolls or for dodging. Either you use your dex if you want for dodging bullets, or you would use your what was the other? You had two ways to do it. Like an acrobatic check. And you could elect to do a minus two on someone's roll if you were dodging, or you can elect to have them do a dex roll. You know, the player dodging would do a dex roll, or do a minus two to the other person's roll, whichever was better for the person dodging, I suppose. I thought that was kind of I want both players to roll dice. I'm one of those guys. I want both players to roll dice when they're fighting each other. I don't want one person to be rolling the dice and the other person is just being passive, you know. You know, whatever you throw at me bounces off and sticks to you, kind of a thing. I want the other player being attacked to have some sort of randomness with what they're doing, instead of it always being an automatic, you know, oh, you're trying to hit me? Well, I'm gonna dodge. So that's a minus two to your roll. Because what does that mean? If the player never says they're dodging, then there's no minus two to the guy's roll? Is that so? Every time a person's getting hit in the game, they have to say, I dodge. Like, that's so much great role play there. I would prefer to have the person defending themselves do some sort of a defensive action and roll and see if they're more successful at their defense than the guy who's successful at his attack, whoever has the higher effect, basically. There was something else missing from second edition, people were screaming about. But it had some stuff that was added. And yeah, one of the things was that second edition was incorporating rules from other supplement books. You know, ideas that came up in advanced character creation. And some ideas that came up in the Prison Planet book. So that's why there's a prisoner career in second edition. Anyway.
That's the way he wrote the story. It was disjointed, I guess, is a different way of saying it. And it wasn't near.
Yeah, but I like it when something cool came out of like a little maybe 15-minute chat back in old Google Hangout days, G plus Hangouts. Calling up some guy, hey, what's up? I got this idea for a character for Traveler. And like, hey, it's, you know, and you bounce ideas off each other. Or something written on a napkin at a Carl's Jr. And that thing written on a napkin ends up being, you know, the fix for the server for a Quake 2 LAN party that's being put together at someone's house for the weekend. You know, stuff like that. Yeah, got to keep those things. Those are the things that kind of improved, made better, saved the day, that sort of thing.
Near the end, that you could put all those pieces together and figure out what happened. We didn't go with that. In August, I found a list of people I wanted on the team, and it mentioned that I wanted Jason Taylor. So that was end of August. And then the next note I have has, in September, actually has him on the team. So sometime between end of August and September is when Jason Taylor and also Jason Anderson got assigned to the team. And those are the only people assigned for the rest of 94. So all the rest of the stuff I'm going to talk about where we got into setting were people who were coming up with these ideas and doing the work on their own personal time outside of interplay hours. In fact, I found At one point, the art director of the company, Todd Camasta, asked me for an art list. And my list is still generic fantasy. It says crossbows, swords, medieval armors, and then generic environments like forests and grasslands and deserts. I mean, this is, we have not thought about this game whose engine was coming together. The sprite engine was coming together. We had not thought of a setting yet.
Yeah, the sprite engine was there. Was the isometric view with the hex map and interiors, and your character was a sprite, and I think the character could stand in 6 directions, or was it 8 directions? No, it was 6. Yeah, it could stand in 6 directions. And if it was behind a wall, you would see an outline of the person's figure. And they were sprites, so, you know, what would be a good sprite game back then? This is like 4 years after Doom, the first Doom, or not Doom. What was before Doom? Was it Castle Wolfenstein? Was that the first one? And then it was Doom? Or was it Doom first and then it was Castle? Anyway, those games that fit on a floppy disk, DOS programs, for 386 computers.
So later, this would be after early September, but still in the fall, so it would be September or October. That's when I sent out that email saying, hey, if anybody wants to think about settings, show up at a meeting. Now, here's where things got weird. I only remember 2 meetings, but my notes clearly say after 4 or 5 meetings, we had settled on. So we obviously had more of these. I did have a note saying, I expected over 12 people to show up, but there was only...
I usually only remember the meetings where there was pizza or a movie to watch. And, or if the Admiral's secretary was pretty, I'll remember those meetings. But what was said at the meeting, I have no idea. But I'll have notebooks full of me just jotting down notes. Getting ready for a trip, going some, you know, up the coast to some military base to do something. And usually I was setting up lands on bases, you know, putting internet in the buildings, then hooking up all the computers to it. Cyber cafes were a big thing in the 90s. So I was setting up those things like crazy for the military. And I remember one guy, actually a couple, every time I would go to one of these military bases, some sailor's getting arrested and thrown into the brig because he's using the computer in the library or at the cyber cafes or in the bars. They had computers in bars, I don't know why. You could order a pizza and then be sitting there playing Quake 2, Quake 3 or whatever on a computer. The guys would, the spies that worked for the military would use those computers to send the ARABs, the schematics of submarines and crap. This is back when Napster was a thing. So there was those kinds of servers. And they would always get caught every time. And then I'd have to do forensics on the machines. That was a pain in the ass. They put scanners on the LAN, like HP scanjets, or the Epson scanners, or the Sharp one, or the Canon one. And the guys would scan the front and backs of their stupid security cards so that somebody at another base could make a copy of it. Like, that's a no-no. Interesting times.
We have that for the for the 4 or 5 meetings. So I was shocked that, like, why aren't people banging down this conference room door wanting to make a new IP? And it was because it was after hours and we're going to get paid for this. The first meeting we had, we basically just threw out ideas. And I said, anybody can throw out any idea. We're not going to critique it, but we will talk about the pros and cons of it as a setting for a computer game. And for things like that, what we talked about is how easy would it be to tell stories in it and to make quests for it? Is it evocative? Are there mysteries out there for the player to solve? Are there things for the player to do? But we weren't going to talk about, that's a dumb idea. I didn't want anyone to do that. I just wanted to say, okay, what would we do with this? Somebody threw out an idea. We all chewed on it. Like, what kind of game would we make with it? The second meeting is when that weird dinosaur spaceship time travel idea came out. I described it briefly in a previous video and also at the GDC talk I did in 2012. That was on the second meeting. It was bizarre. It was overly complex. And that was what most people, we chewed on it. And then most people said that's too complicated. And then we cut it back to just aliens. And at one point we were talking about a setting on future Earth that had been invaded by aliens and humans were hiding in shelters all over the world. And I think that's when I said, well, you know, there's a ton of bunkers out there already. I knew about one in West Virginia that U.S. government officials would go to. And I said, those are already existing. We could do that. From that, we kind of realized we like the destroyed Earth setting, but not so much the alien invasion setting. So that's when we settled on post-apocalyptic. Keep in mind, there was no discussion of wasteland. And I'll make it clear because apparently no matter how much I say things, people don't really hear what I'm saying. They hear what they think I'm saying. In a previous video, I said some people had played Wasteland on the team and some people hadn't, which led to a comment going, I can't believe Wasteland wasn't an influence. They obviously played Wasteland. Yes, some people had played Wasteland. Some people hadn't. Some people played Gamma World. Some people didn't. They were influences on the game, but yeah, weren't actually basing.
That bugs me when these Traveler nerds always say, you know, Firefly is based on Traveler. You know, Josh Whedon, it's rumored. They always say this. It's rumored that Josh Whedon used Traveler to make his Firefly campaign that he played in. So, they always have to say that. It's like pointless information, right? Nerds store the weirdest stuff in their heads, and they like to repeat it all the time. I don't know if that's a spectrum thing on their part or what, but it gets tiresome hearing that constantly. It's like, how about this? Everyone's probably made a setting from Traveler. Who cares? Then they'll say, you know, Traveler came from such and such stories from the 60s or 50s. And I'm like, so what? You know, something happened in a book from the 50s that appears in the Traveler game. Aha! It came from that book. That means that whole book is about Traveler. Well, no. It could be a coincidence. It could just be that one little thing that happened on page 30 of some novel, and it happens again on page 60 of Traveler. I don't think the whole novel is Traveler, but people go crazy. It's all or nothing with nerds. They hear that a game idea or something came from some movie or some book, and they go, ah. Oh. And they don't realize that game settings come from all kinds of other sources. You know, I'm sure Firefly didn't all come from Traveler. That's like the dumbest thing in the world. You can see all kinds of influences in Firefly. You know, just watching the show, you're like, oh, that reminds me of something else. That reminds me of something else. Oh, I know this is going to be a cliche thing. I know how this is going to work. You know, you could argue that Firefly came from A-Team. I love it when a plan comes together. Josh Whedon probably watched a lot of A-Team. So it shows in the TV show a lot. And same with Rockford. Someone watched a lot of Rockford. So, yeah, Rockford. The one guy, Angels. And then you have the other guy who says Rockfish. Reoccurring characters. Fireflies. Just look at Castle. Castle's using Firefly references.
You know, Castle comes from Firefly. You know that, right?
And then there's another show where pretty much all the cast from Firefly showed up on this other show that Falian guy, what's his name? He's in a show. Anyway, don't remember the name of it. I don't watch his TV shows much, except for maybe that one sing along thing with him and Felicia Day. And the guy from Starship Troopers. It was a musical. Kind of cool. Kind of corny. And then there's the... I want to say he played Captain Hammer or something like that. He's the bad guy. He's actually a bad guy in this thing. They call him Captain Hammer. And... but it just bugs me when someone says, "Oh, that came from this, so that means that this only comes from this." Like, nothing else influenced. Like, if they say Fallout comes from Wasteland, that's it. Fallout doesn't come from anything else but Wasteland. No. Wasteland's like one infinitesimal part of Fallout.
Things. We weren't trying to pull things directly out of that game. It's very much a hodgepodge, as you will see as I do this video. There was no hard and fast rules. There was no...
I like the 50s style of everything. But technically, it's weird. The 1950s, the style froze for 100 years. Which I think is kind of cool. It's like, how do you do that? How do you get the 1950s to stay the 1950s for 100 years? Because after a while, people are sick of cars. With the rocket fins... By the 60s, the fins had been gone from cars. Because they, you know, people were tired of hearing about communism. People were tired about rockets. You know, U.S. rockets were crashing and blowing up. You know, they just wanted to watch baseball games. You know, go to baseball games and eat their American pie and their chicken. Before chicken nuggets, there was KFC. Before KFC, there was Kentucky Fried Chicken. There was no McDonald's yet. There was no drive-thrus. Drive-thrus hadn't been invented yet, really. There were the A&W kind of things where you parked your car all around the thing, like a drive-in kind of a thing. The girl on skates would come out to you. Technically, it wasn't a drive-thru. Drive-thrus are where you drive up, pay for your food, and get the hell out of there. You don't park your car and spend the whole night there. Loitering? You buy your food, and then you loiter around all night? No one else can park there because the cars are all taken. All the parking spots are taken around the A&W. How does A&W make money? When people park their cars in the spots all night. Know what I mean? So the drive-thru had to fix that. Anyway, every time something like that happens, people grow up with that and they're used to that. It's what they expect. They start taking things for granted. Then the nukes come down. And everyone has to run to their bomb shelter. Not everyone has a bomb shelter. And for whatever reason, I guess it could be while they're in the vaults, while they're in the bomb shelters, you know, progress doesn't change. Everything's progress doesn't really change until the people come out of the vault and try to rebuild civilization. And since they've been in a vault, all they know is the vault. They're still living in the 50s. the 200, it was the 250s? Because I want to say it was 2050 when the bombs hit. So you had the 1950s for 100 years. Then you're stuck in a vault. 200 years later, you come out. 2250, something like that. 2270. And you grew up in the vault. All you know is the vault. And when you come out, you expect to see maybe some remnants of what you were taught in history of what the world used to be like. So everything outside is still 2050, but blown up. Everything in the vault is still 2050, but just kind of like, it's showing its age. It's hard to repair, it's hard to keep the AC going, the electricity, the fusion generators or whatever. The Protectorons, the Mr. Handys. That stuff is like 200 years old, right? And those generation fallout shelters, people live and die in those things. It's kind of interesting. It's a cool setting.
Directing vision early on. So, we went with post-apocalyptic by the end of the second meeting. And apparently we had at least two more after that. The idea for a vault was mine. However, the name vault came from Jason Taylor. I think I just said, hey, why don't we just go with a bunker? I like the idea of someone coming out of a bunker, not knowing what the world was like, just like the player. The idea of making it a big vault, the backstory about Vault Tech, all that came later. Now, this is where it gets interesting because...
Yeah, the vault is the door, like on a bank, like a time vault lock mechanism. Because bunkers don't have those kinds of doors, but vaults do. Basically, the people are locking themselves up inside a bank, a money vault. Now, safes have a hinge door, and bunkers have hatches like on aircraft carriers. But vaults have thick-ass doors. They're not meant, once they're closed, they stay closed, like hermetically sealed almost. Like the time vaults. They open those things up every 100 years or whatever. It's like, what did someone bury here from 100 years ago?
Remember, I just told you.
Like a capsule almost. Like people on Mars, they would probably be living in vaults. Those would be above ground. Unless the drones they send out there first are going to be able to dig in the ground. It'd be nicer to dig in the ground. Then you, it'd be easier to cover from solar radiation and stuff like that if it was in the ground.
No one had been assigned to the project, and this is well before we had come up with this is what the 50s are going to be like. I found a note from December of 94, and I'm writing about Junktown. Now, Junktown was Scott Campbell's idea, but he obviously hasn't been assigned to this yet. He was at those meetings, though. So he was obviously doing a lot of work. And I just tell you right now, if you like Junktown or The Hub or Necropolis, those were all Scott Campbell's. He had all these ideas very early on. Interestingly, he came on board in early 95, and by the fall of 95, he was gone. So I'll talk about that in a later video, but it was, he had all these great ideas that you see in this junk, in the Fallout that we actually shipped. So sometime around then is when I put together a prototype map. That was not the one with the knights walking around. I tried to make a prototype map that showed, let's see, I wrote down, this is in December of 94. I put together a prototype level to test features like walking around a map, melee combat, opening containers and taking their loot. I believe it later got put out on a as a demo. I'm not sure. So this would have been just me, Jason Taylor, and Jason Anderson. At the time, Jason Anderson was making all the art. Jason Taylor was, he'd come on to run the scripting, the scripters we'd eventually get.
Yeah, the trick with these alphas that you put out, usually you do it when the place is closed. You get some people, talk them to stay over, you know, after hours. They're not getting paid. Talk them to stay after and try some of the software out. Using a server that's not connected to anything, so it's not messing with the production stuff. The trick is getting people to try out the game. Because most people just want to go home. They just want to clock out and go home. You have the salary people that they'll stick around because, I mean, if they're a manager, they're going to be sticking around. I mean, they're being paid salary. They're on the clock. Emergency meetings come up. They're always on the. They're always, you know, 24/7. Especially when you're doing computers, you have no life. If you're working on a project for 5 or 6 years, you have no life. You always hear stories about these guys working for Blizzard or id or EA or BioWare for 2.5 years straight on same game over and over every day, living off of pizza and sleeping on cots in the office, not going home. That's a thing. I don't know if that's still a thing, but in the 90s, that was a thing. That was what you did. And it was just expected of you. Which there's probably laws against that now.
Yeah, and make a scripting language, but instead I think he was making the world editor that we were using to put together the maps. So we started talking more about
I remember I made a font editor for a computer because I got tired of the font that the computer came with. So I made a font editor. And the Beagle Brothers had a font editor for the Apple IIe. And I thought, oh, that's clever how it works. I was playing with it at a friend's house. He was showing it to me how he was making fonts on his Apple computer. And I'm playing with the software. And I thought, this is clever how it works. And when I got home, I started writing the same editor from memory, from what I saw on the Apple screen. I was trying to write it for I think it was the Tandy Color Computer 3 or the 2, I can't remember. So I started writing the font editor for that computer. And after a day or two, boom. Same exact editor was now on the color computer. That was the neatest thing. Then I could start making Helvetica fonts and, you know, all those cheesy fonts that came with Print Shop Deluxe. And whenever someone would print out a flyer, they would use all the fonts on the flyer. It was retarded. So I like the Billboard, the Broadway, the Playboy, the Western, the Gothic, the Century, the Roman, all those fonts that you are basically default now in Windows. I was making those fonts for the color computer. That was neat. But I would do that. I would play around with the software on one computer and then go home and write it on another computer. Because there's no way in heck I'm going to buy an Apple IIe. No way. No way, no how would I ever own one of those. Didn't much care for the 6502 processor. Even if you had a Z80 in the thing and you're running CPM on the Apple II Plus, I didn't care. Don't want it. Yeah, there were other games like Wizardry or something. I think I saw that on an Apple computer. Like, oh, that's a neat game. I think I'll put that. I think I put that on the color computer too. It was a little vector drawing thing. Kind of cheesy, but it works. It was cool. Oh, Infocom did their Zork series and their... what was that other game called? Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. That was on the Apple II. It's like, oh, that's a cool game. So I just rewrote it. I don't know what the source code looked like, but I played the game enough to know how it works. And I just reverse engineered in my head how it worked on the screen to how it would be written on the computer on another computer. Voila, my text adventures were just like theirs, but better. I had graphics in my text adventures.
Apocalyptic, and that's when people came up with, you know, hey, we should do these things that were really good in Wasteland, and excuse me, these ideas that came from Gamma World. And like I mentioned in the video on influences, books and movies and other video games and tabletop games, these were all things that got smushed in to Fallout.
See, he didn't just use Wasteland. It's not just Wasteland. Like, same with Firefly. It's not just Traveler. I'm trying to think. Rule-wise, what's in Traveler that's in Firefly? Anything? Nothing, really. Except for maybe Space Cowboys? But Space Cowboys have always been a thing. I don't think it was much in Traveler, if you ask me.
And you can see those influences in Fallout. You can see Rangers from Wasteland. You can see the leather jacket, which came from Mad Max, not 50s greaser games. These predate Leonard's idea about making it a 50s style game. The leather jacket was what Mad Max wore, which then led to someone wanting to put in the dog and calling it dog meat, which is what the main character in A Boy and His Dog referred to his dog as once. That wasn't his name. The name was Blood, but he called his dog meat. And then guns, people talked about guns, and I don't have a lot of notes on this, but I know our guns came from everywhere. There were real world guns, there were guns from movies. One of the guns came from Blade Runner. Somebody liked the gun in there, we did it. So now we're past 94 into early 95, and I know Leonard got assigned to the project somewhere around March of 95. Now, he'd been coming to all those meetings, and he had been doing after-hours work as well, but he was formally assigned in 95. Sometime later that year is when he came up with that idea of a rule to filter our ideas, which means for all the stuff, meetings we'd had in 94, and for a big chunk of 95, we just threw things in that we liked. Junktown, ghouls, giant scorpions. I mean, these were things that you could see in any...
Yeah, it has to be things that the creators have to like what they're putting into a game. If they don't like what they're putting into the game, guess what the game's going to be like when it's finished? If it gets finished. So that's the secret. You have to like what you're doing. Some people say, oh, it's fun to program computers. Well, you have to like programming computers, first of all. So I wouldn't call programming computers necessarily fun. It's challenging. It's rewarding. It's interesting. When you challenge yourself to learn new technologies when you program, that's neat. At first, it's daunting. And you're like, oh, really? Now, unless it's assembly language, it's usually going to be interesting stuff that keeps you want to keep learning, right? The more you learn, the more you want to learn. That's how computers are, at least. Unless you're doing assembly or Ruby.
1950s or later, post-apocalyptic sci-fi. Horrors of Nuclear Devastation movie. But it was sometime in late 95 when Leonard had his epiphany driving about, hey, why don't we make this future what the 50s?
Ultimately.
A lot of our ideas came from those. thought the future would be. So suddenly we had a great rule for defining our architecture.
Yeah, it's like now you have an alternate to work with. Because you don't want to get stuck with, is this our future? Because this is being written in the 90s, and the 1950s were 40 years ago. This is what the thing is with Traveler. Traveler was written in the 70s, and it splits. The far future is an alternate future. It's not our future. And a lot of the chuckleheads that play Traveler, they think the game is our future. And I have to remind them, no, it's not. And then Mongoose comes along and does a reboot of Traveler. So not only is it not our future, but now it's a reboot of not our future. And I got hiccups. Why do I have hiccups?
Our robots, what our tech would look like, and influence the music. I mean, that's why we look for that old style music to open up with, even though we already wanted a more ambient sound for the game itself. I mean, when people talk about there were 50s music, Fallout was not riddled with 50s music everywhere. It was pretty much used in the opening and the closing cinematics.
Yeah, it was like some 30s music. And then Fallout 3 continued with that too, with the older music that was before the 50s.
So that's as close as I can come to recreating the origin of Fallout setting. The nice way of saying it is it was a very organic process. It was a melange, a blend. A worse way of looking at it is it was very haphazard. We just threw a bunch of stuff in, and what stuck is what we liked and we kept. Because of it, I hope how I describe this, you realize this is why it's really hard.
I like the junkyard, the cars. All those old cars in a junkyard. You could still recognize the style of the car, you know, if it was a sports car or if it was a sedan or if it was a bus of some sort or a garbage tow thing. It was really cool. Because you only had what? You only had two views, I think, of the cars. They were either angled this way or they were angled this way. Kind of weird. Could you see the cars straight on or, you know, perpendicular? I don't think there was a perpendicular view of the cars. They were always at an angle when you saw them.
Hard for me to point at an influence. And it's hard to say who's responsible for one feature because, like, just from the name alone, you know, I'm sure there's somebody who was in those meetings and went, I was the one who thought of the name Fallout. Yeah, but I'd say Brian Fargo is responsible for the game being named Fallout. Because of that, it's hard to say, like, well, who thought of this robot or who thought of this piece of armor? Because there were a lot of armor and I think even one robot design in the game before we went with the 50s aesthetic. But those things all kind of fit. But you can
usually in the credits it just has the artist name, like in Mongoose Traveler Second Edition. My name's in the book for animals, and because I designed an animal and I did the artwork for the animal. But in the credits it just says animals. It doesn't say, and I think the days are gone now when artists put their little initials and the date on the pictures when they submit their art to a game book. Or anything. The name and dates are not there. So unless someone does a Bing search of Cyrene Geestworm, which it's a different language. It's Danish or something. Maybe German. I don't remember, but it means the siren mind worm or siren spirit worm, something like that, if you translate it to English. Because the people that first encountered the thing, I don't think they spoke English. There's a whole, if you do a search of that thing, you'll see the origin of it. There's a YouTube video about it. So when I'm long gone, that'll still be on the internet when people ever are curious about what was that thing? You know, like this is when Traveler 8th edition is out and people are like, I still play 2nd edition. Yeah, remember that thing in the 2nd edition book? And when they do a search, they'll find it, you know, 50 years from now.
You can see some armor, like metal, that metal shoulder armor, spiked armor that you're like, I don't remember seeing that in any 50s movie. You're right. That got thought of and put in before we ever thought of that aesthetic. But it still kind of fit with the whole Fallout-y vibe. So
the trick, though, is you have the artist draw this stuff, but then someone goes around and names everything. Everything has to have a name. Like the gyromatic, or the lawn mowing nuker or something, and it always has TM or registered, because it's supposed to be a product endorsement, and then you see the commercial in the game of the item that you're using in the game to kill people. It's like you later on you see the TV commercial of it being advertised. And it was all modern appliances in the 50s, that kind of thing. And it's cool how they came up with names for the robots and for the cars and for the radio. What's the radio company called? Like Radiation King or something like that? It's kind of cool. And the comic books had names, had brand names.
I just want to say that the setting, ideas came from many places. They passed through many hands. They eventually got filtered through Leonard's aesthetic. But there's a whole bunch of parts and individual features of the game that resonate with us, the people who made it, and also with you, the people who played it. And that, you know, vibe is partially what we put in and partially what you brought to it. And that's as close as I can come to a definitive, here's where Fallout setting came from. That's why I like to talk to other people who worked on it. They can provide more insight, but that's as close as I can come to a timeline of the creation of Fallout setting.
That's a good job.
You found that informative.
It's a good thing you kept all that stuff.